The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hi, my name is Joel Berman, publisher and CEO of National Mortgage Professional Magazine, and I would like to welcome you to National Mortgage Professional Magazine's webinar titled Third Party Oversight, an AMC's Perspective on Protecting Your Business, sponsored and presented by StreetLinks. I would like to thank all of the webinar attendees for taking the time out of their busy day for this very valuable and informative webinar in our ongoing series of webinars. We have two presenters on today's webinar. First, we have Mike Floyd, Chief Appraiser, Senior Vice President of Compliance at StreetLinks Lender Solutions. A practicing appraiser for nearly 20 years, Mike currently holds a certified residential appraiser license from the state of Indiana. As a founding member of StreetLinks' predecessor, Superior Appraisal Services, Mike assisted in the training, education, and internal quality assurance of a team of over 30 appraisers. His insight and expertise helped grow Superior from a local appraisal firm into one of the largest direct appraisal providers in the Midwest, and eventually one of the largest and fastest growing non-captive AMCs in the country. As StreetLinks chief appraiser, Mike created and implemented the company's extensive quality control and appraisal risk analysis procedures, which proved to be instrumental in enabling StreetLinks to become an industry leader. Today, as StreetLinks chief appraiser and senior vice president of compliance, Mike focuses on product quality, continuing vendor and internal education, consistent client communication, compliance with industry standards and AMC-specific legislation, and new product development. Our second presenter is Kelly Taylor, senior vice president of StreetLinks Lender Solution. Kelly has 20 years of mortgage industry experience, managing national retail brand systems and multiple location call centers, as well as large broker platforms. His management experience and leadership has been instrumental in StreetLinks' rapid growth and success since he joined the team in 2007. As senior vice president, Kelly plays a significant role in all aspects of the company, including strategic planning, sales, marketing, operations, and product development. As a mortgage industry leader with a strong understanding of the issues facing today's lenders, Kelly brings a unique perspective to the appraisal management business and remains a driving force in StreetLinks' ability to evolve with the changing regulatory environment. We will be sending out the PowerPoint presentation and the recording of the webinar to all webinar registrants tomorrow for your future reference. Before we get started, we have two poll questions I would like to address to today's audience. I will report the results after the questions are posed. First question, do you feel like your current partners measure up to the industry's compliance standards? If you will answer yes or no, I'll give you a little bit of time. About 20% so far say no, and we're about 80% that say yes, and we're still going to keep the voting open for a little bit more. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We're going to close the voting, and now I'm going to report the results. We have 77% that said yes, and 23% that said no. Very, very interesting results. Let me pose question number two. Are you considering partnering with a new appraisal management provider in 2014? Once again, give you some time to respond, yes or no, and I will report the results before we continue with the webinar. Once again, we're running about 70% no and about 30% yes, and we're going to keep the voting open a little longer. Five, four, three, two, one. The voting is closed, and I will report the results. We have 70% that said no and 30% that said yes. Well, at this point, we're going to move forward with our webinar featured for today, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce you today's first presenter, Mike Floyd.
Joel, thank you very much, and I'd like to thank everyone who is joining us today. This is a topic that that StreetLinks cares a lot about, and I'm privileged to speak with you all today about it. Briefly, we'll go through today the following points. What does third-party oversight actually mean for your organization? Why your AMC relationships deserve primary attention? What to ask your AMCs during an audit? What AMC actions you're responsible for, and what to look for in a new provider should you decide that your current provider is not meeting your regulatory requirements. So, how will third-party oversight impact your current AMC relationship? Well, as we all know, in April of 2012, the CFPB issued their very brief and somewhat vague guidance on the topic. Thankfully, though, in October of 2013, the OCC followed with a very detailed and highly descriptive bulletin, which went a long way in identifying what regulators may be looking for in terms of how a lending institution oversees and audits their third-party service providers. And then the FRB, in order to basically not be left out of the party, followed suit with their guidance in December of 2013, and they didn't step too far out from basically what the OCC was indicating. So all three of these regulators have issued guidance outlining the lending institution's responsibility for all aspects of their third-party relationships, and basically they're signaling to the lender that those relationships will no longer be considered that of a subcontractor. Your AMCs and other third-party service providers will be more akin to an agency relationship, basically making you responsible for pretty much all of their actions that they take on your behalf. If you doubt that AMCs fit the criteria to be considered as an important third-party service provider, one only needs to look at the actual guidance from the OCC, which outlines 7 points. Any single point could demonstrate that your third-party service provider is one that requires significant oversight and scrutiny. And AMCs fit 5 of those 7 points. And failure to oversee your AMC is certainly going to set up significant potential risk, both from a financial and a reputational level. We'll talk a little bit about that later. So on the next slide, we can see the OCC complexity identifier. These are the criteria that the OCC set, which identifies a third-party relationship that they feel is going to be one that's very important for the lending institution to scrutinize. So one of those identifiers is relying on a single third party to perform multiple activities. And we know that there are many AMCs that operate as settlement services, both for not only for appraisals, but for title, for flood certs, and various services along that lender's value chain. So the typical AMC relationship would certainly fit with that identifier. Working with third parties that engage directly with consumers. AMCs interact directly with banking and lending customers for a variety of reasons, to schedule appraisal appointments, to explain the appraisal process, to mitigate appraisal and valuation disputes, and to collect payment. But perhaps most importantly, an AMC is the only provider within the lending chain who sends someone who is not part of the lender's organization into the home of your consumer. Now, I've done thousands of appraisals and I've been in thousands of homes, and I can tell you that there's not a single situation where the borrower did not have at least some bit of trepidation about this stranger encroaching upon their home. So definitely as the only time that that someone is being sent to the consumer's residence, this is a very important relationship in the eyes of your regulators. Contracting with third parties that subcontract activities to other foreign and domestic providers. Obviously, AMCs use independent contractor appraisers that are out in the field all over the geographic United States. Additionally, many AMCs may subcontract even a portion of their own appraisal management function to domestic or foreign providers. So certainly no question that they fit that criteria. Contracting with third parties whose employees and facilities are geographically concentrated. Obviously, there are many small regional and even state, local state AMCs that most likely exhibit a contractor base that is highly concentrated within that state or that region that they cover. And then working with a third party to address deficiencies in bank operations or compliance, well, obviously, the primary reason for AMCs really to exist is in order to assist the lending institution with their regulatory compliance as it relates to appraiser independence. So now for a little bit more on this specific topic and how it relates to you, I'll hand the presentation off to Kelly Taylor.
All right, thanks, Mike. I appreciate that. So what does third-party oversight really mean? What does that mean for you? What does it mean to the lender? I think it means ultimately lenders are responsible for the actions of their third-party agents, including their appraisal providers. And so say that again. That's a scary thing to say. I mean, the bottom line is lenders are ultimately responsible for the actions of their third-party agents, including their appraisal providers. So yeah, that sounds scary, but is that like Bigfoot or Loch Ness Monster scary, something that sounds scary but you've never seen it, or does that really happen? And the reality is that does really happen today. Lenders are now being held responsible for the actions of their third-party agents, including their appraisal providers. So what is a real-life example of that? And I think you can search the Internet, and you'll see there's several well-publicized circumstances of several AMCs just unexpectedly closing their doors. They're taking orders one day, everything looks great. The next day, no one's answering the phone, the website's down. If they're local, all of a sudden you see, drive by their offices, the lights are off, there's a sign in the window, out of business. So there are cases where that's happened, and some of the notable ones, Appraiser Loft, Evaluation Services, reportedly left millions of dollars in unpaid appraisal fees that ultimately the lender was held responsible for, meaning that ultimately, even though the borrower might have paid for that appraisal or the lender might have paid for that appraisal, to the AMC, the appraiser was never paid, so therefore the lender was held accountable and had to pay that appraiser. So that's what I mean by the lender is held responsible for the actions of their third-party and appraisal providers. So, and it's more than just that part of it too, though. It's failure to select and audit a fully compliant AMC can create a reputational risk, not just financial risk. But what does that really mean? I mean, it's how sophisticated is the AMC that you are using today? Is it run like a small business, or is it run like a well-organized institution? It doesn't matter that it's necessarily small, but if it's small, it has to be run like a well-organized institution as well. So what I mean by that is, do they have the sufficient financial clout to ensure that they pay their appraisals in the event of a downturn? So just using that prior example, so if you're a small business and you're taking orders in today, and you're using that money to pay for appraisals that were done a month or two ago, that model only works as long as volume is increasing. As long as that volume continues to go up, it's great, sort of like the old Ponzi scheme. But as soon as that volume drops, what happens is now you're not bringing in enough revenue to pay for your past bills, and you collapse in a hurry. So there's that financial risk, but I think maybe even a bigger one is the reputational risk, which is, do they have the systems, the hardware, and the firewalls necessary to keep that information confidential? So if you're a regional lender or a local bank, you have to be perceived in that community as being a trusted party, and that credibility goes out the door instantly if all of a sudden there's a news report of somebody hacked into your appraisal management company's database and got your customer's confidential information. They got some of their loan information. They got other information out of their files because they didn't have the hardware or the firewalls necessary to keep the bad unscrupulous people out. So when that gets out in the industry, then your reputation can be shot in a hurry. So those are the type of real issues that you need to be worried about when you're talking about third-party oversight and how you're held responsible. But so just to go through a few things, what is the lender really held responsible for? And so I keep talking about the appraiser has to be paid. That's great. So that's one example. But what else is there? So it's appraiser compensation, not just, you know, were they paid, or were they even paid timely? You know, there's a lot of different regulations that require when the appraiser is paid, depending on the state. But I think in about every scenario, they have to be paid in 30 days or less. But besides that, it's were they paid fairly? I think everyone has heard of customary and reasonable fees. It's one thing to ask your AMC, well, are you paying customary and reasonable fees? It's another if they can prove it. So if you ask that question to your AMC and they can't show you the methodology behind how they're paying customary and reasonable fees, and I mean show you as soon as you ask, then the odds are they may not be compliant. I mean, you have to really understand what is their methodology and when was the last time they reviewed that methodology and how do they know it's current and active today. Are they do those type of things to ensure the appraiser is paid compliantly? Appraiser independence. You know, that's obviously a big thing that's happened over the years, making sure the appraiser is not influenced. But it's one thing just to say that are they being influenced or not, but it's another to say what are you doing to help the appraisers out if there is a situation where they feel influenced, meaning that does the AMC have a hotline set up to help the appraiser that they can call if they have questions on that? Do they have email addresses set up? Do they have a team of people that are there to help the appraiser in the event that they feel pressure or they feel like their independence is being threatened? Do they have that or do they not? Appraiser selection. Seems like a simple thing. The AMC, they're going to pick the best appraiser for the assignment, right? But that's not always the case. It's you know, reminds me really of a quote from a movie. So if you've seen A Few Good Men, you know, it doesn't matter, you know, what I believe. It matters only what I can prove. And the AMC has to be able to prove, did they pick the right appraiser for the assignment? So if you believe they picked the right appraiser, that's great. But what can you really prove it? If a regulator, you know, calls you the carpet and says, how do you know the right appraiser was picked? You have to be able to explain that methodology. So is there documentation and is there proof that they are picking appraisers based on geographic proximity to the property? Do they have track records of historical quality? Do they have service metrics on the appraiser for those particular assignments? Do they have that, or do they simply just have a panel of appraisers in a geographic area that they rotate? You know, next in line, you know, gets the next order that rolls through. If that's the case, then you might not necessarily be able to approve the best appraiser was picked for the assignment. It's certainly not as good as being able to say, yeah, I know my AMC picked the best appraiser because they base it on this. The closest appraiser with the best quality and the best service metrics gets that order, not just next in line. So that's the type of stuff that we're talking about with appraiser selection or quality control. Every AMC quality controls the appraisals, right? You know, does that really matter? The facts are, yes, it absolutely does. Does AMC have sophisticated quality control that is tailored to each individual situation, the individual requirements of that state, the individual requirements of that lender, the requirements of that particular appraisal type? Do they have that type of QC process, or is it more just, let's just make sure that the pictures are there and let's ship it on to lender and let them look at it? And that's the type of stuff that your AMC has to have, and if they stand behind that, then valuation delivery. That's a big one this year, right, that some people were scrambling around with, or how do I get the appraisal to the borrower? Now I have to get that to them, and I can tell you that I have heard from other lenders that are now our customers that have said, my other AMC would take care of that. They would just, you know, attach a PDF and send it off to the borrower when the appraisal was completed. And if that is what your AMCs are doing today, that is absolutely not compliant. That is not a compliant way to send an appraisal in today's world. There has to be electronic delivery disclosures where the borrower has agreed to electronic delivery, where they've signed off on that. There has to be a secure link sent to a borrower where they can put in some sort of a security type of question or answer to prove that they are the person that should be receiving that. The AMC should be able to give you reporting around, you know, the date and time and proof that appraisal was clicked on to ensure that borrower got that. It's so much more advanced than simply just attaching a PDF and sending it. So those are the type of things that are the scary world that we live in today, that the right AMC or the proper AMC, you know, can help you take care of those regulatory issues. So, you know, what is the moral of the story? The moral of the story is it's no longer acceptable to simply ask your AMC if they have the right policies regarding compliance. You can't just ask the question. You have to trust them certainly, but verify that they have all of the right processes in place, and that's the responsibilities that are yours today. So when it comes to that, auditing your AMCs, I'll turn it back over to Mike, who's the person that certainly developed a lot of our policies and procedures around that, so he's the right person for that topic. Mike?
Thank you very much, Kelly. I appreciate that. So now, obviously, since Kelly and I are such outstanding speakers, we know that we have you all convinced that it's time to audit your existing AMCs. But the question now is, where do you start in auditing an AMC, particularly if you've never done it before? Well, honestly, the first place that you should start is ask your account representative to put you in touch with dedicated compliance associate or a dedicated compliance team. You need to be able to actually speak with and potentially meet with those people within the AMC's organization that are dedicated to compliance, not only compliance with lending regulations to make sure that you stay in compliance with your regulators, but also compliance with the AMC's own regulators, which happen to be the individual states. Next, you need to establish your own audit goals and objectives. Now, this should be a fun process for you, because I guarantee you, if you're anything like the typical customer that I get to speak with, there are things that your AMCs are telling you that they do that you're very skeptical of, that you say, you tell me you do this, but I see situations where it just doesn't seem like that's possible. So you need to make a list of all those things that you're skeptical of that your AMC tells you, and then you need to make sure that you dig into each one of those things on a transactional level. You need to go from transaction to transaction through some random samples of files that the AMC isn't aware of up front, where they can show you, yes, this is how we selected the appraiser, and this is the quality control that we did, and here are the revisions, if any, that we asked the appraiser to make. Here's how much we paid the appraiser, and here's when they were paid. So you need to go through that at a transactional level. Certainly all those things that Kelly talked about as far as the appraiser selection process, you need to be able to look at, okay, how far away from the property was the appraiser you sent? Was the appraiser, within 25 miles, or did they send somebody from 80 miles away? While there may be some extremely rural areas in the country that 80 miles might make sense, in most areas, certainly suburban and urban areas, if an appraiser is being sent from further than 25 miles away, there's really only one reason to do that, and that's because the appraiser's shopping for the lowest fee, rather than trying to find you an appraiser that has intimate knowledge of that marketplace. So once you identify your goals and objectives, you need to establish a time to actually get in front of your AMC, either bring them to you or you visit them, and we'll talk about visiting your AMC's locations as an important step later on. But I will say at this point, StreetLinks has created a compliance guide that will be provided to all the participants shortly after this webinar is completed. So compliance guide is kind of a step-by-step process where we've looked at what our clients have held us to, our larger lending clients that put us through very routine audits. We're giving you a little bit of an insight into what we've been held to and potentially what you should be holding your providers to. Next, prepare your own audit template. So again, if you're not sure where to start with an audit template, basically what that is that's a point-by-point agenda for all the things that you're going to want your AMC to be able to show you, and not only tell you that this is what we do, but actually be able to show you the policies, the procedures, and documentation behind that. So one good way to prepare an audit template is to go through the OCC bulletin that has all that very detailed guidance. StreetLinks has prepared one based upon that OCC bulletin that we would be certainly, again, able to provide after the webinar that basically just goes through, now keep in mind, this is our interpretation of what we believe, based only upon our experiences,
that you would want your AMC provider to be able to show you as part of an audit. We certainly can't guarantee you by using our audit template that you're going to be you're going to mitigate all your regulatory risk, but we can tell you that we do have some history with this, and we're willing to give you a an idea of where we start with the process with our own template. And part of that template will be some of the things that you can develop and know the right questions to ask. So we'll talk about some of those questions here in just a moment. Some of the things that you can quickly identify a warning sign for an appraisal management company that maybe you want to look at replacing, certainly those finances that Kelly already talked about. If they can't consistently and as soon as you ask provide evidence of their financial security to be able to not only pay their appraisal providers but also be able to pay their own employees in situations where there's a market correction, then you've got to get out of that relationship, because that is a ticking time bomb, and that's a situation where they're going to put you as a lending institution in a bad position, either financially or reputationally. Data and physical security. Kelly touched on this a little bit, but you know, the truth is you need to have a provider that can provide you with evidence that they have fully redundant both physical facilities and data centers located within climatically different geographically regions of the country. The reason for this is no more evident than the past winter that we had, one of the worst winters on record, or at least in the last 50 to 100 years, through much of the Midwest. And certainly the ferocity of that winter weather caused all kinds of issues basically on a weekly basis in terms of the amount of snowfall, certainly ice storms and things of that nature, that I'm sure those types of things interrupt the ability for a business in that region to seamlessly continue to work. So you need to know if your supplier has locations in geographically diverse regions of the country, so that if Indiana is having an ice storm and brutal cold temperatures to where there's going to be an emergency declaration and nobody can get to work, you need to know that they also have a physical location, fully redundant, and can handle all the same services within a temperate or tropical region of the country, so that there will be no significant interruption to their service levels. If your provider doesn't have that, it's only a matter of time before they're going to suffer a significant interruption in service, which again could have a significant impact on your reputation and ability to close loans in the time frame that you have to do that. And then also, does your provider have established and written policies and procedures that they can provide you on a moment's notice for maintaining compliance with each of the licensing requirements and the administrative rules for each of the states that they operate in? Right now there are 38 states that have active or pending appraiser licensing acts that come with them a litany of different rules that AMCs have to follow. So you need to be able to see quickly how the AMC is managing to those requirements, and if they don't already have those policies written and in place, then they cannot be compliant today. It would be impossible. There are just too many regulations that they would have to be compliant with to not have policies in place. So we'll get back now to some of the questions that you should ask during an audit. This certainly isn't all of them, but these are some of the main points. We've touched on a few of them already, so I'll gloss over a few of these, and I'll handle a few of the others in greater detail. But so one of the first things is documentation demonstrating compliance. So is it enough to just have a policy document? No. You need to have policy documents. You need to be able to show procedurally how those policies are put into place. And then finally, you need to actually have case studies where you can show examples of situations where your policy has actually performed in the manner that you intended. For example, if a provider has appraiser independence policies, they should be able to show you case studies where their employees have followed those policies and it has mitigated a potential appraiser independence risk. And so that type of case study example goes all the way down the line for just about every policy that your AMC would have. We've talked about evidence of financial reserves. That's an easy one. Site visits to redundant physical locations and data centers. So is it enough just to ask your AMC if they have redundant facilities and data centers? Probably not. Because without a site visit, you're not really going to be able to tell whether or not the secondary or backup location has the sufficient facilities and IT resources in order to basically operate and fully replace the primary location in cases of an interruption in service. So you need to actually make those site visits, and I can tell you that most of our larger clients are doing that on either an annual or a biannual basis. Your AMC needs to have formal written policies for how they manage their panel of appraisers. You need to be able to see the steps that they take when an appraiser performs outside of service levels or in substandard quality, that they're not just, you know, saying, "Ah, oh, that appraiser missed the boat this time. We'll get him on the next trip around the rotation." They need to have written and approved policies for how they discipline that appraiser. Anything from possibly suspending work with that appraiser until the appraiser takes additional education, all the way to potentially removing that appraiser from their panel if it's a continued pattern or a serious enough issue. You need to obtain formal policies for internal QC. Basically, the AMC needs to be able to show you repeatable, consistent, and scalable procedures for how they quality control the appraisals before they're delivered to you. Why is scalability important? Because certainly if an AMC is out there utilizing only licensed and certified appraisers to provide their quality control, and they don't have any process for handling, you know, appraisals that are identified to have lesser risk or lesser issues within their policy and procedures, what's going to happen when there's a spike in volume? That's not a situation that's quickly scalable to the point where you can add someone and train them for all of your everything that you're looking for in that process within a time frame that's going to allow them to basically keep up with that spike in volume. So the AMC should be able to show you how their policies for that QC are scalable, because, you know, for a reputable AMC, that quality control process is going to be one of the most time-intensive things that they do in their service to you. Does your AMC and can they provide you with evidence of periodic background checks for employees and subcontractors? You know, obviously, this is important. More and more appraisal boards are instituting background checks for as a requirement for appraisers, so we don't know going forward how important that's going to be if the state boards handle that. But certainly, you know, you want to make sure that the AMC is background checking their employees and any subcontractors they use to help them with the appraisal management functions, not necessarily the appraisal, because you need to make sure that the employees are keeping your information that is confidential, that your regulatory bodies require you to keep confidential, that the AMC is doing that. Physical security at each location that the AMC operates out of. Now, again, this comes down to, are they able to protect the confidential information that you've entrusted to them? Because if they don't, and there's a Graham-Leach-Bliley violation, you know, you're talking about penalties of $10,000 to $20,000 per instance, and you're on the hook for that if your AMC is not providing for that security. Does the AMC have formal HR policies and procedures? Now, what I mean by this is, we said that the AMC has to manage their appraiser panel, but do they also manage, train, and discipline their own employees who are responsible for quality and service of the deliverable to you? Do they do that as actively as they manage their appraisal panel? So you want to know that if they've got an employee that's substandard, that's not
taking care of business on the level that you as the client expect, that there are going to be some proactive management and discipline of that employee so that type of thing does not continue. Then obviously evidence of professional liability insurance so that you know that fiscally your provider can cover situations where they've failed to live up to the level of service that you expect. So finally, I'm going to send everything back over here to my friend Kelly to talk to you about what you can look for in a new AMC going forward.
All right, thanks, Mike. I appreciate that. So I was asked within the last couple of months by a person that I'd met at several conferences around the country, and he came to me and he said, "Hey, KT, you ran multiple like call center locations, right?" And I'm like, "Yeah." And he said, "Well, you also ran retail branches all across the country." And I said, "Yeah, I did that too." And he said, "Now you run an AMC. So who better than you to help me pick out some new AMCs? They're changing their processes, and we want to bring on a couple of new AMCs." So I thought about that for a second. I said, "You know what? I'm going to write down a few things that would be important to me, and I'll call you back, and we'll go through some of those." So that's really what this slide is about. So I'll go through some of those just from my perspective of things I think you should demand from your AMC. And so, you know, so I wrote down large and established partner. So, you know, why would I say that? Does large really matter? What does established really mean? So the reason I put that on there is because I want to have an AMC that can handle my business as I continue to scale. It is a hassle, and I don't want to bring on different AMCs every time I have a chance to pick up a high-performing, you know, branch or a group of folks in another state. I don't want to have to now start that whole process all over again. So I want somebody that I can scale with. But even more important than that, I want somebody that's established, somebody that has been around, that understands the rules and regulations and the requirements of all the different places that I want to lend in. So I'd want to pick somebody that is, you know, is large and established. That's what I mean by that. But, you know, below that, what really matters? And some of the stuff that we've touched on a little bit, but it's, you know, I want to make sure they would have a dedicated compliance team. You know, it's virtually impossible for any AMC to keep up with the litany of requirements necessary to withstand, you know, the intensified regulatory scrutiny and which, you know, the lender is going to be subject to if they don't have people that are dedicated towards that. They have to have a senior executive whose primary focus is on compliance, or in-house legal counsel with a sufficient staff that can handle that and keep on top of that. So, and all the things that we've talked about. So they would have to have that. That would be an absolute requirement, or I wouldn't even consider them. So there's that piece to start with. The built-in QC. I'd want to have the combination of manual and technology-driven QC functions. I mean, I want to have technology, of course, because I want to make sure that all of the different data points within the appraisal are being handled the right way, and that it's fast. But I also don't believe in just technology to review an appraisal. I think that is crazy. You have to have people still look at, read and interpret the text of what the appraiser wrote, you know, look at the pictures, make sure does this really make sense. So it would have to have a combination of both manual processes and QC driven by technology in order for me to consider that AMC. So there'd be those couple of things, a dedicated compliance team and a built-in QC process. And also what I mean by QC process is they need to be able to show to me what they are quality controlling. So if I get an appraisal from that AMC, I want to know, what did you look at, or more importantly, I guess, what did you find that you considered to be a problem, and how did you rectify that problem? You know, show me where that is. That is what I want to see. So when my collateral review teams get them, that I really understand, you know, what were the flags, so to speak, in this appraisal, and how did you overcome those? Because every appraisal, or most appraisals anyway, are going to have issues with those. It doesn't mean it's a bad appraisal. I just want to know what are the issues so we can dedicate our time, effort, energy, and money around, you know, is that issue big enough deal to me or not to make it a deal breaker. So that's what I mean by built-in QC. And full compliance and audit trails on every single order. I don't want to have to, if I get an auditor comes in and wants to start regulating me, I don't want to have it all on me. I mean, I'm good. I think I know what is going on, but I don't, you know, have the time to be able to know exactly what's happening on every single appraisal that I had when I was lending. There's way too many appraisals. So I want to make sure there's a full audit trail there. So if someone comes in and says, what happened on the Jones file, that AMC can recreate exactly what happened on that. They would know why this appraiser was selected, how they were paid, you know, what was QC'd, what were the issues, all those sorts of things, that they have all of that, you know, in hand, ready to go at a moment's notice, that an auditor wants it, they can have it immediately. So that's what I mean by a full compliance of audit trails on every order. Certificate of compliance. That sounds like a simple thing. Anyone can make a certificate, right, and put it on there. But I want something to be able to show to my regulators or to whoever I sold the loan to, any of that, that at least I used a company that, you know, a certified statement of compliance that provides, you know, a well-documented outline, you know, to again, to the lender or the successors, that the regulatory requirements were met on this specific appraisal on this specific loan. So I'd want to have that on every single one. You know, let it be known. Let it, you know, gold stamp. You know, put it on top of the appraisal on every time. Just have that type of thing. So I'd want to have that. And then there's, you know, all this publications that I've talked about, you know, multiple times about, you know, payment of the appraisers and how important that is. But I would want to have an AMC that paid the appraiser as fast as possible. Again, so if they're paying every 30 days, it would probably be 60 days down the road before me as a lender would even know if the appraisers were being paid or not, or 90 days, which means my liability is every single appraisal that I ordered over the last 60 or 90 days, I could potentially be on the hook for, versus if I had an AMC that was actually paying the appraiser at inspection. Wow, then my liability is virtually zero, because as soon as I order that appraisal and I go to inspect it, the appraiser is paid, so I have no issues with that whatsoever. So the earlier they paid the appraiser and the earlier they could document they paid the appraiser, the better off that I would be. So those are all important things that I think you have to have, but just as important as all that is they would have to have excellent customer support team, meaning that, so if I'm running this large lending organization and I have a question on an appraisal, I don't want to have to call into 1-800-whatever to try to get a question answered. I want to be able to have a dedicated person that can understand my question. I don't want to talk to a clerk and explain 3 or 4 times, you know, what my question is. I want to be able to talk to an in-house appraiser, you know, a person that says an appraiser advocate, so to speak, that could answer my questions and get me the details or the answers that I need. Or if they can't get them right away, they could at least have the expertise and understanding to call the person that did the appraisal, have that conversation with them, and then get me my answer. So that's what I mean by customer support. Or if I'm running an organization and there's something that's burning, it's a purchase. I've been there before where the person sold their home and all their stuff's on a truck. They're expecting to close, and now there's some sort of problem. They can't close. They're sitting in a hotel, and it's all your fault as a lender. That sort of drama that I'm talking about. So been there. I want to be able to call somebody that understands that issue, that is empowered to resolve that issue and just get it done and with as little as hassle as possible, you know, my dedicated client advocate, so to speak. So those are the things that I would demand from my current AMC, or certainly from my new AMCs if I was bringing one on board. I think those are the things that I would have to have. So when I was asked to help him or consult with him, so to speak, on what to do, then those are the items that I gave him, and I think they ring true for most circumstances. And you know, before we get to the questions, there's just one other thing that I read on Friday that I just wanted to share. Maybe some of you guys have seen this, but it was in, you know, National Mortgage Professional Magazine. It was an article that came out on Friday, and I saw the title and I'm like, wow, that's something. The title was OCC to Loosen Oversight Leash on Big Banks. So of course I pulled that article up right away. I said, well, I've got to see what that has to say. We're talking about, you know, regulations and how things are getting tighter. And one of the things that is said in this particular article, and this was just in you know, National Mortgage Professional Magazine on Friday, was, I'm going to read this as verbatim as I can. It says, this news comes to us on the heels of reports that the Fed will begin monitoring small and mid-sized banks more heavily in the wake of the financial crisis. Now that the big banks are already under control of their watchful eye, broadening their scope seems to make sense. The Fed is paying close attention to loans submitted to FHA around the time of the crisis and whether or not the current underwriting guidelines were met properly. So the key points of that is the Fed will begin monitoring small and mid-sized banks more heavily. So I think that rings true, that, you know, the attention might have been on the big players, and they're the ones that got the OCC or the CFPB, you know, breathing down their necks. But now that they feel like that, so this has have those folks on the right track. They are now targeting their sites on the smaller to mid-sized banks and lenders. So that is a very timely article to come out before this, but that is the reality of the world that we live in today. It might seem scary, but with the right provider, it's not necessarily scary. It's just an opportunity to pick up market share. So that's thought that was a timely article. But with that, we can transfer back to Joel if there's any questions at all. We have 10, 15 minutes left, I guess.
Absolutely. I thank you both, Mike and Kelly, for your presentation. And we do have a number of questions, and we'll try to get them in during the time that we have left. The first one comes from Steve from California. Has StreetLinks been audited for a third-party oversight?
Well, I will take this one. Steve, thank you for the question. Well, we're not directly regulated or audited by kind of the regulators we've been talking about, the OCC, the CFPB, or the Federal Reserve Board. But we have been audited many times, including on-site visits that I was discussing in my part of the talk by several of our largest clients. And I can tell you that most of those audits that we received were based upon things that their regulators were demanding that they be able to provide as it relates to their AMCs and that particular third-party relationship. So we don't get audited directly by the regulators, but we do by our largest clients. And I guess in addition to that, I can tell you that even the clients, larger lending clients that haven't yet conducted a full audit, maybe they're still waiting on the results of their regulators' examination. They have delivered extensive RFI documents to our compliance department, which basically touch on all of the different requirements from the OCC bulletin to basically say, hey, look, we are either going to be audited or we need to make sure that we clear up any potential shortfalls we think we might have before we have a regulator knocking on our door. So it's definitely clear that at least the larger institutions are being scrutinized for compliance in this area. And I guess based upon the article from Friday that Kelly was talking about, I think it's certainly only a matter of time before that filters down to the mid-size and smaller lending institutions.
That's a good one. I just want to point out that quite a number of questions are coming in, and if we do not have the time to answer your questions, all of these questions are going to be forwarded to StreetLinks, and a member of their team will be able to respond to you directly. I also want to remind you that the PowerPoint presentation and the recording of this webinar will be sent to you by email tomorrow. The next question comes from Glenn. As a mortgage broker using a lender's designated AMCs, are we shielded from non-compliance issues, partially, completely, or other? Good question.
That is a good question. Again, I think I'll chime on this, Kelly, if you don't mind. As a mortgage broker using the dedicated platform of the AMC, meaning I'm taking it to mean that you mean one that you're directed to use, you are completely insulated from this type of oversight. I mean, this type of oversight is going to go directly to the lending institution that has developed the third-party relationship. As a broker, you really haven't developed and maintained that relationship because you shouldn't have any input into the selection of the AMC that's going to be servicing your files.
So the only thing I would add, Mike, is that I agree, yes, but I believe the broker would still have some sort of liability or culpability when it comes to appraiser influence, meaning coaching the borrower, be there at inspection and trying to influence the appraiser unduly. You didn't select them, of course, but be there to try to influence that appraiser in some other way. But other than that,
absolutely
agree.
Yeah, great point, KT. So obviously, if at any time, you know, any type of communication with an intent to influence comes about, certainly you as the broker can't be insulated from that just because you didn't pick the AMC. Good point, KT.
Next question comes from Ruth from New Jersey. Why does StreetLinks believe that this topic is so important?
I'll pick that one, Mike. Because I think reputation is everything. And so I got a call just today from the largest lender in the entire country. And they asked me, they said, hey, KT, we're thinking about this type of technology, and you know, you say you're a technology company, so do you guys do this? And I thought about that for a second, and my answer was, I said, you know what? No, we don't. We'd be happy to build that, and we'd love to do something like that, but no, we don't. And his response to me was, you know, I appreciate that. Appreciate that honesty. So many people just want to say yes and then try to figure it out as they go, but I appreciate the honesty and transparency to say, no, we don't. So reputation is everything. So you can't cut corners and not get bit someday. So as you know, AMC regulation intensifies, escalation of, you know, licensing costs will directly impact the financial stability of AMCs. And you know, what happens with that when that AMC goes out of business? Then, man, you're on the hook for all that money. I you know, explained that a couple of times. Or if they don't have the firewalls or IT security you need, and that data gets breached, and that gets out, you know, to the news agencies, the such and such AMCs, you know, data was breached, and now these all these borrowers working with this lender has potentially a confidentiality of their information, you know, is out in the marketplace, and that is scary, and that would ruin or could really damage a person's reputation. So reputation is everything. I think you have to hold it dear and do everything you can to protect that in everything that you do.
Yeah, and you know, I would actually like to add a little bit more to that. It becomes near and dear to StreetLinks because so many people don't realize the level of AMC regulation that is out there today. As we touched on briefly in the earlier presentation, there are currently 38 states that have active or pending AMC licensure and registration acts, and which with each of those acts comes a litany of regulations and administrative rules that the AMC has to follow. And while most of these statutes are in their infancy, once the appraisal boards who are responsible for this, for enforcing this regulation, once they get fully funded and catch up to the point where they can start performing some audits, there are going to be some AMCs out there that haven't been paying attention to anything other than obtaining a license, that when the regulator comes knocking and wants to perform an audit, they're simply not going to be able to pass it. And you're going to have a situation where one day your AMC provider can operate in a state and the next day they no longer have a license to operate there. So, again, obviously reputation is important. And if you have a situation where you have to run out and try to find an AMC to cover a state that you're doing a significant volume in that you don't currently have a relationship with, that's going to certainly impact your reputation.
Yeah, quite a number of questions still coming in. We still have some time. The next one comes from Bill from Colorado. It's really a three-part question, so I'll give you the first part. What is your sense of the third-party oversight responsibility of the non-self-funding traditional broker shop that has no direct input in the selection of an AMC or appraiser and yet must consider the company as a third-party vendor? The second part is, who must the broker oversee? And the third part, the lender or the AMC or the appraiser? If you want me to bring that back again, I'll do it.
I think I kind of have it. So as it relates to AMCs, the broker does not have a responsibility overseeing that third party for the lending institution. Now, a broker that is a third party provider to a lending institution, they certainly have to comply with all of the other, I guess people call it the alphabet soup of regulatory acts, and be able to show in their relationship with the lending institution that they are in compliance with all of those different acts, you know, the Fair Credit Reporting Act, all the different parts of TILA, RESPA, ECOA. So as a third-party relationship, you know, there are certainly different requirements that a broker has to comply with. Where they're somewhat insulated is they aren't required to manage any part of the oversight of an AMC provider, which is, you know, what we're talking about here today. Obviously, other than making sure that they comply with the communication requirements that the lender's established AMC has decided and maintained. And then, Joel, what was the third part of that question?
The second and third part were connected. Who must the broker oversee, the lender or the AMC or the appraiser?
Well, again, the broker certainly shouldn't be overseeing the appraiser because they should have no part in the selection of the appraiser. The broker isn't going to be overseeing the AMC because the AMC is not their third-party service provider. They're the service provider of the lending institution, and the broker should have been directed to that AMC. So again, they don't oversee that, and the broker doesn't really oversee the lending institution either. The lending institution should oversee that relationship with their brokers. The broker's responsibilities, though, are to understand what the regulatory requirements are on that lending institution and then make sure that they have policies, procedures, and documentable case studies in place to show that they are keeping that lending institution in compliance with those regulations, or at least that they're not doing anything to throw that lending institution outside of compliance. Because again, the broker is a third-party service provider of the lending institution as well, and so the lender is going to be held responsible for what that broker does ultimately within the process.
Okay, the next question comes from Ben from Texas, and I guess because the size of the state, it's a long one, but I think a good one. Let's say I complete the audit you suggest and select the AMC that successfully met the outlined criteria for the audit that you outlined. What should I look for on an ongoing basis as warning signs after I've established that relation, possibly indicating a troubled AMC?
Well, again, I guess it would be the things that we've kind of spoken about already. And that would be, reach out to the AMC appraiser panel. If you're a lending institution overseeing the third-party relationship, you have a right to know who the AMC is using to complete your files. So on occasion, reach out to the appraisers. I mean, you're going to have those appraisal reports in your hand. You know that the AMC is using those appraisers. As long as it's not loan production staff and it's somebody completely insulated from loan production within the lending institution, have your chief appraiser or your quality assurance staff reach out to these appraisers and make sure that they're getting paid on time, that they're communicated with up front in the engagement process, that the AMC is giving them clear and distinct requirements in the engagement terms as far as, these are the expectations we expect for quality in your report. These are the service levels that we expect. We need the report in by a due date because, obviously time is of the essence in the lending cycle, and there's a time limit on providing your customer with the appropriate terms. So that would be the number one thing that I think that you could do is certainly take at least a random sample of the appraisals that you've gotten in. Have the compliant personnel within your institution contact those appraisers and just ask them whether or not the AMC is paying them on time, whether they give those clear directions up front in engagement, and whether or not that AMC follows up with them quickly and keeps the process rolling in times when there has to be communication between the two.
Okay, I think our last question comes from Nick. And his is, how does StreetLinks ensure that the appraisers are paid customary and reasonable fees as mandated?
Well, I can tell you we go by the two presumptions of compliance, and this answer will take a lot more than what I can do on the phone today. But we have clients that utilize both Presumption 1 of the Interim Final Rules and Presumption 2. So those clients that utilize Presumption 1, we provide them with a fee study of rates that have been recently paid to appraisers. Now, under Presumption 1, those can include rates that have been paid historically by AMCs. And then we use that information together to establish a customary reasonable compensation level. Under the second presumption of compliance, we allow the lender and assist the lender in doing a fee study which does not consider fees historically paid by AMCs, and then they come to a determination of what the lowest fee that they would be willing to pay for individual assignments based upon a litany of criteria like geographic region of the country that it's located in, the scope of work and complexity of the assignment, the type of appraisal report form, the type of loan program, and so on and so forth. So that's certainly a question that we can answer after the webinar in greater detail, and certainly we'll try to provide that information to whomever's asked.
Very good. There are definitely more questions that are going to be pushed your way for a response that we do not have time to respond. I want to remind everyone that the PowerPoint presentation and a recording of this webinar will be sent to them via email. And I would like to thank all the attendees and, of course, today's presenters, Mike Floyd, Kelly Taylor, and, of course, StreetLinks for today's presentation. This concludes today's webinar. Unless there's anything else, Mike or Kelly, you would like to add?
No, thank you everyone for their time today.
I just want to just say one thing that's sort of my own commentary. There's no question that the regulatory environment is causing the cost of compliance to be a lot greater than a lot of us expected, but the cost of not complying is so expensive that that's something we need to be concerned with. This topic, and I used to be a mortgage broker, and I wasn't under an AMC, and I was able to actually select my own appraisers and so on, is a completely different environment than I was in. And all I could say is that StreetLinks has provided, I think, the foundation to be able to look at your AMC, be sure that they are compliant, ask lots of questions, and if you don't get the answers, then I'm going to just say, think again about doing business with that AMC. Thank you for attending, and I have a great rest of your day.